This is an extremely rare and valuable one-sheet poster for The Master Mystery, a silent film serial starring Harry Houdini. The poster was only one-third there, and we recreated the rest, and you will see that incredible journey of restoration today on Poster Fix. Hi, I'm Chris. Welcome to Poster Fix Studio. Today, we have a very special, very rare poster printed in the early part of the 20th century. For a 15-part movie serial starring Harry Houdini, we only had the middle section. This is a reproduction on the right, which we are going to use as a guide to recreate the missing parts.
Yeah, you have to make enough space.
Yeah. So you have to recreate this.
Yeah, I have.
And there's this Otis Litho logo, which is very blurry here, but I may find it somewhere else. Although I'm not too worried.
Is it repro?
Yeah, very, very repro.
Is it original?
Yeah. And this is a terrible, bad repro on glossy paper.
The back seems to be clean of any tape that I can see. I'm going to start by pouring some wheat paste that I made the day before into this bucket and getting it all nice and mixed together at the right consistency is very important. I'm taking this screen that has stretched cotton canvas on it, and then this piece of acid-free paper, which I will dose with water, and then cover it with a very generous application of wheat paste. This wheat paste is similar to the stuff used in wallpapering, however, it is a finer grade, and I mix in a fungicide as well as an acid neutralizing agent. I then pick up the paper full of wheat paste and apply it to the canvas. In case you don't know, Harry Houdini was the most famous escape artist of all time. He was a superstar, internationally known. Handling wet paper can be a trick, but after 36 years of restoring vintage posters, I think I've got the hang of it by now. Because of his superstardom, Harry Houdini yearned to also be a film star. The paper has some air pockets between the paper and the canvas, so I want to roll it out to help the paper expand and to make sure it's lying nice and flat on the canvas. These Houdini posters of any kind fetch a lot of money. They're highly collectible. Linen backing is a process where we take a vintage poster and mount it to a piece of this acid-free paper, which is mounted to the cotton canvas. This is an archival mounting process. It helps the poster to be stronger so that it'll last longer.
The small red screen is ready to go. We can linen back onto it now.
Don't go away, we'll be right back. We're back in the shop, and we're going to flip the paper around to apply the wheat paste. As I apply the wheat paste, the poster will be inclined to expand. That's right, it actually gets slightly bigger in size because there is pores in paper. As I apply the wheat paste, the paper stretches out in all directions and subtly expands. I also have to make sure that it's good and wet. If I miss a spot or I have a dry spot, it could create an air bubble or something like that. So now I've let the poster absorb the wheat paste for a few minutes, and then I gently lift it up, again, wet with wheat paste, and flip it around. I'm positioning it on the screen to allow room on the top and bottom for the missing areas. That which you see in the foreground, which is a reproduction. The Master Mystery is a 1918 American mystery silent serial film told in 15 installments. The film was directed by Harry Grossman and Burton L. King and written by Arthur B. Reeve. and Charles Logue. The film stars Harry Houdini, Marguerite Marsh, Ruth Stonehouse, Edna Britton, William Pike, and Charles Graham. Episode 1 was released on November 18, 1918 by Octagon Films. In the plot, Justice Department agent Quentin Locke is investigating a powerful cartel that is protected by the Automation, a robot. However, it uses a gas weapon known as the Madagascar Madness. Floyd Buckley played the part of the robot known as Q, the Automation. Master Mystery is the first lengthy film production featuring a robot, or an automation, as it was called back then. Harry Houdini was, at this time, one of the world's biggest stars, and a successful businessman as well. And now, he also wanted to be a film star. Hoping to capitalize on Houdini's superstardom, producer B.A. Rolfe of Rolfe Photo Plays hired him to star in a 15-piece serial called The Master Mystery. Film serials were already a staple back then, but the most influential serial maker was, without doubt, French director Louis Foulade, who pioneered the mystery thriller in 1913 with his legendary five-piece Fantomas, featuring a master villain specializing in elaborate disguises. Foulade further developed the genre with his 1915 serial Les Vampires, The Vampires. Despite the name, there are no vampires involved. Rather, it is a story of a band of mysterious ninja-like masked females, villains, and murderers terrorizing Paris. The series is today considered a milestone in the mystery thriller. Now that I've rolled the wheat paste, excessive wheat paste, and air pockets out of the poster, I'm taking a sponge and cleaning off the surface and all the wheat paste that's hanging around the edges. Want to make it nice and clean.
And over here, we're mounting these three Houdini handbells.
These three Houdini handbells were printed on a kind of toned paper. They have a browning around their edges, which is most likely caused by acid. And they absorb the wheat paste very well and are flattening out nicely, although they're much more delicate than the movie one sheet. There are some very small letters on these handbills. Very tiny. Now I'm taking the sponge and once again cleaning off the surface to make them nice and clean. And trying to think about what I'm going to do to restore them. They have an inkling to move around a bit when I pass the sponge over them. This one in the foreground is completely split in half, so I've got to move it around some more. Incidentally, these handbills were to promote a live show and are not connected with the film Master Mystery. Take a look at this. This is a lobby card from episode 7 of Master Mystery. And it shows the bad guy, the robot, named Automation Q. Fascinating robot design for 1918. This predates Metropolis by Fritz Lang. I never knew there was a robot in the silent movie era. We're going to limit back this one as well.
I'm putting it on the screen with these other Houdini artifacts. open and put new paste on it.
I'm gently removing bits of old scotch tape, which is very stuck to the back of this lobby card for Master Mystery. Primarily directed by Burton L. King, the primary writer of the series was Arthur B. Reeve, a very popular pulp mystery novel writer at the time, best known for his book series about Detective Craig Kennedy. Houdini's character, Quentin Locke, is basically a reworked Craig Kennedy. One might think that if you are going to make an action-packed escapist fantasy, you could have come up with a slightly more exciting frame story than patent fraud. The bad guys run a firm that buys up inventors' patents and suppresses the sales of the products, thus raising the price. Quentin Locke is a federal detective who has infiltrated the firm to try to indict them through antitrust law. As the story progresses, we also get an Oliver-like paternity and inheritance drama and a love triangle. But pretty soon, Locke's investigations are interrupted when he dashes off to find a cure for the mysterious poison that induces the Madagascar madness. His investigations are hampered by a league of evil henchmen that try at first to stop him, then kill him. Rather than just shoot him, they seem to have a perversion for tying him up in chains, handcuffs, barbed wire, ropes, nets, crates, below elevators, next to acid, in Chinese torture machines, electrical chairs, straitjackets, and so forth.
So I've attached the first piece of paper to the bottom of the poster. Now we're going to do the top piece.
Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Well, this poster is dry. A day has passed. My wife is going to go into this poster and try to recreate what's missing.
During the first five episodes, they try to drown him three times. Although guns are readily available, no one ever gets the idea to just shoot him. Indeed, the series is primarily thought up so we can watch Houdini escape from one set of restraints after another. As the series progresses, each episode starts with Locke freeing himself from one trap and ends with a cliffhanger of him getting caught and tied up again. Sort of reminds me of the Batman TV series. My wife, Okhee, is using paper pulp to fill in the cracks that exists between the pieced-in paper and the original poster. And once doing that, she goes in there and sands it to make sure it's nice and smooth. And now let us commence with the recreation of the missing images in this poster. The missing letters, the missing background, the missing banner at the top. We're going to trace the missing parts from the reproduction, and then we're going to use a transfer process to move it from the traced paper onto the blank sheet, which we are going to do the recreation. Using skilled pencil work and so forth, my wife is going to be using water reversible gouache to create all these colors.
You put too much edge on here.
Yeah.
I measure this amount. But there's this much of gap here.
So what are you gonna do?
I'm gonna make a little bit more original is here.
You're gonna raise it a little bit?
A little bit raise, and then I'm gonna make a little bit space of it here.
Okay.
You understand?
Yes.
Oh, and then there's the robot. As mentioned before, this is the first outing of a robot in a lengthy feature. The first screen robot was presented in French special effects pioneer Georges Millet's short film Vogus et l'Automate in 1897. And quite a few short variations had been done on the theme since. The first feature film robot was presented 2 years after The Master Mystery in the Italian film The Mechanical Man. This robot is a bit less scary than The Mechanical Man in French director André Dide's comedy. Q, the automation, as he is called, frankly looks to be made out of a 10-gallon drum from hips, air ventilation ducts for the body, and a bucket for a head, with large glued-on comic book eyes, The fact that he has a smiling face cut out of the bucket doesn't make him less cute. Lumbering jollily along around the film, even making small victory dances when he has taken out some good guys. The series itself rests pretty much on Harry Houdini. As the anonymous reviewer of the British Film Institute writes, quote, "Houdini was not your usual leading man material. Short, woolly-haired, compactly built with an impressively large head and an intense brown-knitted expression that almost never relaxed. Yet, he managed to overcome his odd appearance and mannerisms through sheer personal magnetism. You can't take your eyes off him." Alongside the film Terror Island from 1920, The Master Mystery is considered Houdini's best screen work, probably owing to the fact that he didn't write it himself. And he seems to be better suited for the short format of the serial, where he can frequently show off his amazing physical prowess. He was a veritable bodybuilder, as well as his amazing escape skills. This serial is also superbly well directed when compared to the turkey that was The Man from Beyond, strangely enough made by the same director. In that film, his escape acts were often flatly filmed from a distance without any flair for the dramatic. In this series, the escapes are kinetic, well-filmed, supremely edited, and filled with energy and action. Houdini did occasionally use stunt doubles throughout his short film career, although he naturally never admitted it. The camera work is extremely well done as a whole. As Raymond Owen of Pop Matters puts it, quote, "Cinematographer William Reinhardt is the real star of the show. His striking photography features multiple deep compositions and an ambitious chiaroscuro. A short dialogue scene in Chapter 10 is an early example of alternating over-the-shoulder shots, something that became quite common in filmmaking and in television shows when two characters are talking to each other face-to-face. The series was very popular, but ultimately its biggest flaw is the erratic and flimsy plot that sometimes gets lost for entire episodes.
Because there's a space like this, so I have to cut here and then adjust a little bit bottom part. And then I have to cut this one too.
That's great. That's awesome.
Don't go away, we'll be right back. We're back in the Poster Fix shop and my wife Okhee is gently creating the pieces that will fill in the missing areas of these handbills. Back on the subject of this movie, The Master Mystery. Although it probably worked a lot better as a cinema serial, the acting is generally stereotypical and mediocre, and none of the characters apart from Locke stand out. As a whole, a well-filmed and enjoyable action serial with a few spectacular escape acts and a kinetic Houdini, but ultimately the plot is too thin and repetitive to hold up in the long run. Although he cannot be faulted for not trying, Houdini never became the movie star he aspired to be. Raymond Owen concludes, quote, "Alas, it was not to be. Houdini's strenuous grab for stardom was in vain. Each of his movies made less money than the ones before. His acting was bad, his indistinguishable scripts worse. He made 4 feature films under The Master Mystery. 3 of them survive." For those of you watching Okhee doing the touch-up and recreation of this poster, please know that we use water-reversible colors, things that can be reversed should the poster need to be re-restored in the distant future, say in 100 years. If for no other reason, because it's been abused. Storage is important in the care of vintage posters, even after they've had restoration. They are still delicate artifacts of paper. They weren't meant to last forever. At PosterFix, we strive to make your posters stronger so that they'll last longer. After 36 years of restoring vintage posters, I can still say that I look forward to seeing what you're going to send me. There are always surprises out there, and it's a delight doing the research into these posters to make these videos, and I appreciate your interest in listening to them. At the end of this video, I'll give you a message on what you should do if you want to contact me about restoring your posters, so stay tuned for that. And now let's watch Okhee finish this off. One thing that I myself cannot do is recreate small letters with a brush. My wife is actually recreating the Otis Litho logo. The Otis Litho Company of Cleveland, Ohio is perhaps best known for the posters that it produced for early silent movies and several prominent magicians of the 1920s, such as Thurston, Carter, George. But the Litho Company did produce a few circus posters for Hagenbeck Wallace during the period before the American Circus Corporation was purchased by John Ringling. These circus posters produced by Otis in the 1920s are also very scarce, and there are very few examples of them known to exist.
What?
Okay.
What? What happened?
This one I first tried to, because it's black.
Yeah.
The pencil doesn't work.
Oh. Look at that, it transferred. Voila! Wow. Now I just gotta touch up the lines like here and here.
Okay, Houdini. Okay. Goodbye, Houdini. Houdini. I need some more pattern here.
That about wraps it up for today's edition of Posterfix Studio. If you have any questions about the restoration of your vintage posters, please send me an email, tell me the size, tell me the condition, show me a few pictures of the posters, and I'll get back to you with recommendations and a price. I look forward to seeing your posters. Thank you.